And when you have repeated properties in section shackle, I said it is probably the most controversial part because, I have to say as a disclaimer that when I was part of the working group as Simon, and some people said me that I was part of the sex camp, and so I, if you think that what I'm going to say is you don't agree because I am just defending sex, I'm sorry for that, because I mean, I have to say that I am part of the sex community group and I collaborate on that. But my personal opinion is that both are interesting and probably in the future they should converge. I think it's, we can continue having two languages, but probably is not necessary in the future. But on the same time, I think that there are some features for sex that I really wouldn't like to not have. For example, cyclic data, so recursion and cyclic data data models, because they are really very important. So that's why I think that in the future, Shackle needs maybe another version where you could say, okay, let's have a recursion and negation and all the features that have been done. And also in the recent years, there was more advances in the theoretical point of view that could provide some light on that. Okay, with that said, I have to say that this was like a disclaimer. So if you think that I am just defending sex, sorry for that, but that's not what I intend. I intend to compare both of them, and let's continue. Also, I had this short intro to the foundations of sex and shackle. If I have time, I wanted to give a very short intro to the abstract syntax and semantics and validation, so you can see that they are not so much different. So at the end, there are some things that are different, but not so many. And that's the idea of this slide, common features. I mean, there are a lot of common features between sex and shackle. They are both with the same goal, but from a different philosophical point of view that I'm going to talk later, but the goal maybe is the same. Is you want to put constraints or you want to describe and validate RDF graphs. They are using the word shape. That's why I titled this tutorial Shapes, Applications and Tools, not sex or not shackle. They also have node constraints, and the node constraints are very, very similar, because that was the node constraints from sex and from shackle. They were mainly done during the working group, so they are very similar. They also have constraints on incoming and outgoing arcs. They also allow to define cardinalities, have different default cardinalities, but they also allow that. And they also have RDF syntax. The syntax is different for the RDF of both, but they also have that. And they also have an extension mechanism, but a different one, but also have a mechanism that allows you to extend the language. But there are all these differences, and I'm going to review these differences. First of all is the underlying philosophy. This is from my point of view, but when I started with sex, with shape expressions, I was looking at shape expressions as a grammar. So you can, in a grammar, when you define a grammar of a language, you define what are the valid constructs of that language. I think that the people who were doing shackle and some people who were thinking about how to define shackle were more trying to focus on validation and defining constraints. For me, that's a philosophical point of view that is different, but it marks some decisions also. For example, if you define a grammar, you also want to know what are the valid nodes, and not only the nodes that are not valid, but also the valid nodes. While if you are just defining constraints, and the previous question, he was talking about constraints. For me, the idea of safe expressions is not just a constraint. It is much more than a constraint. It is to define a grammar of the a data model of the RDF graph. While just plain constraints, you would just say, okay, I have several constraints and check those constraints. If you look to inspiration from that, from the XML world, it is as if sex would be more inspired by DTDs and XML schema, where you have more like a grammar, while a Shackle is more like Schematron, where you have some constraints and you check those constraints. But also this difference is not exactly, this point is not exactly the same, because Shackle also added some, in the Shackle core, it also has some components to define this kind of grammar. So at the end, Shackle is more like a mixture of both. Okay, so this is but also there is this focus on validation results in sex, while in Shackle has more focus on the errors and the violations. In fact, for me, one problem that usually happens when you use Shackle is that if you're very well what nodes have been validated. And something that happens, at least for me, at least to me, is that sometimes the target declarations were not right, and some nodes were just ignored by the validator, and you don't know that they were, the nodes are valid. You just, it says that it is valid, all the safes graph. While in sex, as you obtain also information about what are the nodes that are valid, that's very useful. Okay, so that's from my point of view. Also, the semantic specification, it was evolving at the time when the working group was done. Sex was more defined in terms of, I mean, we have this well-founded semantics from where we combined recursion and negation. We had at that point of time this paper about where you have the semantics of validation of schemas. What we did to combine recursion and negation was to have a stratification. So it's like you remove some parts that are controversial, but you allow recursion and negation. In the case of Shackle, the description of the semantics was based, the recommendation was based on a combination between text and natural language and Sparkle. But I have to say that later, it was 1 year after the Shackle was a recommendation, there was this paper, which is a very interesting paper, where they provide a definition of Shackle more in the line of sex, which where you have an abstract syntax and semantics and all that, but also combines recursion with negation. And I think this is a very interesting thing that probably, as I say, in the future, that's the line where Shackle should work in trying to define this semantics where you allow also recursion. There are several syntactic differences in the abstract syntax, the compact syntax. In these slides, you will see I use for Shackle the RDF syntax, but this is because as I received several people complaining, saying, okay, but you are comparing the compact syntax of sex with the turtle syntax of Shackle. But the idea is that Shackle has the real syntax of Shackle is not the compact syntax, and it was something that was done later. Also, I don't like very much the compact syntax of Shackle because, for example, you can define several things in RDF that you cannot define in the compact syntax. So it is not round trip, while in the case of sex, everything that you have in the compact syntax can be put in RDF and the other direction also the same. So that's something, that's why I think the compact syntax of sex has more, I mean, it has been done with more work because sex had in mind from the beginning this kind of compact syntax, while Shackle, the compact syntax was defined later. And this is a comparison between the compact syntax. So you can see that they are very similar. So they are similar. So you have this, they are similar, but there are references. Okay, but I'm not going to go into too much details there. About the RDF vocabulary, you have this. You have the sex representation in RDF. For example, in this case, this is a clear winner for Shackle because Shackle is much more compact. Even if this is Turtle, at the end it is Turtle in both, but this is much more compact than here. In Shackle, it is a bit more verbose because at the end, this is the how it allows you to translate from here. You can generate the compact syntax while from the RDF, you cannot always generate the compact syntax. That's the difference. Okay, but at the end, this is much more compact. So it's much more readable Shackle in Turtle than Shex in Turtle. Okay. I also said that the notion of shape between Shex and Shackle is different because in Shex we separated the shapes from the shape maps, while in Shackle both shapes and target declarations are integrated. But I also received some complaint here, and I put this note here saying that you could always have a different graph where you put the target declarations, so you could have at the end this kind of shape maps where you have the target declarations. In fact, I implemented a converter between Shex to Shackle and Shackle to Shex, and the conversion between Shackle to Shex, for every shape, I generate both a shape in Shex and a shape map in Shex. Okay. Well, the default cardinalities you have in Shex is 1 and 1, and while in Shackle is 0 and unbounded. This is just a stupid thing, but also it defines the way. This decision also marks how the difference between Shex and Shackle and what I was saying about constraints and grammars. For example, if here you can see that in Shex that you are defining like a grammar, and if you don't say anything, you expect there is a given name and a last name, while here you are just defining constraints, and if you don't define anything, it is just like saying that there is no constraint, that you have a given name but there is no constraint, so you can have 0, 1 or unbounded names. Okay, so that's the difference, that by default Shackle is more based on constraints, while in Shackle is more based on a grammar based. There's a big difference here between allowing property paths. In Shackle you allow property paths, but in Shex you don't allow property paths, and you can only have predicates or inverse of predicates. But at the end, most of the things that you can do with property paths, you can emulate them in Shex, and that's the next example. For example, you have this grandparent in Shackle is where you have 0 or more nodes of person, and you can emulate that saying, okay, grandparent knows a person node star, and person node is knows a person node. So if you have recursion, you can emulate this property path in Shackle, in Shackle, in Shex. But there are some pathological cases of property paths that took this decision of not allowing property paths in Shex, because we could have here, for example, instead of payment, just put a path, but we decided not to allow that because in this way, in Shex, you have more control about the cardinality, while in Shackle, you have this kind of pathological cases, and this is something that this example was given to me by another person, and I didn't expect the behavior here. But for example, imagine here you have an invoice that has one payment, and this one payment has one amount which must be a decimal. So for example, in Shex you have these three invoices. In this case, this invoice, the I1, should be okay, and this is okay both in Shex and in Shackle. In this case, you have an invoice with two payments, and this should this should be not correct. But in this case, you have a payment with an amount, and you notice that you have two blank, that you have it looks similar, but they are two blank notes. So you have, in this case, you have two payments with two different blank notes, and in Shackle, the answer is that it is conforms. So notice that this is a quite a pathological case, but this is something that the use of property paths in Sparkle, because I mean in Shackle, which at the end is inspired by Sparkle, can lead to some errors. And this is an example of an error where you expect to have an invoice with only one payment, and you could have more than one payment. Okay, so be careful if you are going to use. If you're planning to use property paths in Shackle, be careful with that. Okay. About inference, I have to say that sex and safe expressions is completely independent from inference. We don't use any property from any vocabulary from RTF schema or from OWL. But that's not the case in Shackle. And in Shackle, there are it is, as I said before, it is like if you have Shackle has its own inference, so it has its own entailment, because you have this RDFS type slash RDFS subclass of star, and that's something that I think if you want to validate, for example, data where you have RDFS, so that you have, for example, where you want to validate data that is RDF data that is representing an ontology. Depending if you activate inference or not, the results in Shackle could be different. And that's something that is important to take into account. For example, we are using nowadays, we have a project in Spain where we are using safe expressions to validate ontologies. In Shackle, you can do that, but you have to be careful if you activate inference for those ontologies. Okay, and this is an example. For example, I mean, these are examples a bit tricky, but just trying to show the problem. Imagine that you have in your data, you have you combine data, for example, Alice, Bob, and Carol. Alice is a teacher, Bob teaches algebra, Carol teaches logic, and you have this in this data, you have the teachers, the domain is teacher, and teacher is a subclass of user. In the case of sex, it doesn't depend if you activate inference or not. Alice wouldn't be okay because has the name, which is a number. Bob has the name, which is a number again. Carol is okay because it teaches logic and the name is a string. So this is okay in both without and with RDFS inference. But in the case of Shackle, for example, as you have the possibility to check the user, if it is a subclass of user, for example, teacher is a subclass of, so here Alice is going to be checked if you don't have inference, but notice that, for example, Bob has the domain of a teacher, so it should be a subclass of user also, but if you don't have RDFS inference, it will be ignored. I don't know if you understand the sample, but imagine that if you try to validate without RDFS, Bob would be ignored because it wouldn't be the target of this shape. While if you activate RDFS inference, it will not be ignored and it will be will be validated. So that's why I think that this kind of messing with RDFS vocabulary has this kind of non-intended consequences. It's not the end of the life, but I think that's a problem from my point of view. Also, another big difference between sex and Shackle is the use of, I don't know how to, Okay, is the use of repeated properties. Repeated properties, I think I talked before about that, is, for example, you have a person has one parent which is a male, another parent is a female, but you are using the same property, but with two different data models. In the case of Shackle, you should go to qualified value shapes. That's the difference that I wanted to say, okay? In the case of recursion, I also talked about that later, before. It is undefined, so I don't need to go into more details. And you can also simulate that also with art discriminating types, and also And also you can simulate with property paths, but it is not very easy to simulate that with property paths. Finally, also, well, that another example with closed shapes is, for example, a closed. Okay, if I have another different from name or fourth name, the system should complain. So I say that this is a closed. And it works in sex, but in the case of Shackle, notice that even if we put closed equals true, the system that will not go to check the values of the properties here. So here, this example, the Shackle validator would complain saying that there are more properties than the listed ones. So here we should add the way to solve this is to solve is to add a declaration of ignored properties and to put the list of the properties that the closed should ignore. But notice that that's not very intuitive because you are expecting that a direct translation between sex to Shackle would convert this just to plain this. Okay, so that's just another tricky thing. Okay, so this is also the same in property paths, they are also ignored. Also, something that Shackle has and sex doesn't have yet is comparison between values. Uniqueness also doesn't have, in the case of Shackle, they have the unique lang. This is a property constraint that was added to Shackle Core because it was very useful. Also, modularity, we also have extends, and sorry, we also have import in sex and in Shackle, so both support this kind of where you import a schema from another domain. But there is another thing which is quite tricky, is when you want to reuse shapes that come from another, from imagine you have shapes from a library and you want to reduce to use those shapes that come from a library, but you don't want to touch those shapes, you just want to reuse. It's like inheritance in Java, for example, in an object-oriented language. So for example, imagine you have here you have a product. Product has a product ID and a price, and then you want to say, okay, but I want to reuse that definition of product, and I also want to add a purchase date and product ID. But notice that you want to extend it. So if you had a product ID with a string, now you want to have another product ID. One possibility is just to do the conjunction of the both. So here, the product ID in this case would check that it should be a string and an alphabetical character. But maybe you want to add, to extend this product with another property, product ID, which is different from the previous one, okay, with a different data model. So this is, in this case, this is one possibility is extending by conjunction. This is what it works in Shackle when you put an AND. But there is another possibility is to extend, so this is the one that you want to extend, but adding the new property. So this is something that we are adding to sex right now. The next version of sex, we are expecting to have this extend keyword, which so where you are going to say, for example, book extend product, product. If product has this data, then I add this property. So for example, a book, for example, Moby Dick would be a product would be a book that has two values for the code. Okay, so this is something that we are adding to sex. I skipped this slide. There is one way to have to extend saves that is supported by Chakra and not by sex is to leverage subclasses. So for example, if you say you have a product that is a save as before, and then you define sold product as a subclass of product. In this way, as all the RDFS subclasses also will be validated as sold product and as product. Okay, but in sex we don't have that concept of class and we don't mess with that. Okay, another difference is between exclusive OR and alternatives, and this is also, it was a surprise when I met this example, is for example, imagine that you have in person, you want to say you have either first name or first or last name from the fourth namespace, or you have given name and family name from the schema.org namespace. So you allow those both. So for example, Alice is using both name, first name and last name. Schema both is using given name and last and family name. That's okay. But if you combine, then that's not okay. And this is, and this definition can also be defined in Shackle. So in Shackle, you can try to use to replicate that with X1, exclusive one, but you have to be careful because in Shackle, it seems the same, but if you have a partial match, for example, this one, in Shackle, it doesn't complain. It says that it is okay, this partial match. And notice that it has a first name, a last name, and a given name, but doesn't have the family name. So this is, I mean, we think that it should be wrong, but in Shackle it doesn't complain for that. Okay, the way to solve this is to enumerate all the possibilities. So that you can normalize and enumerate all the possibilities, but notice that this simple example now in Shackle would be much longer, so it would be like 2 pages longer. So that's the way to solve this way. Then another difference between sex and Shackle is that you can have annotations. Annotations in Shackle are built in, so you have this kind of several annotations, but you only have these built-in annotations, while in Shackle we allow this kind of comments, and this kind of comments internally are represented as triples. So internally every shape in sex is an RDF data, and what if you have the shape of person, then you could have this label and comment, and you could also have other annotations for these nodes. Okay. As I also said, the validation report in Shackle is defined, while in Shackle we define result save maps. That's another difference. And the extension mechanism in Shackle, it is using Shackle Sparkle. There is another thing called Shackle JavaScript. In sex, we are agnostic with regards to the programming language, so you can use semantic annotations where you say, in this case it was JavaScript, but you could just say any other language. So for example, you could say, okay, the start date is this date, and I mark the start, the end, and then I compare the start and the end date. You can do the same with Shackle. But you can do the same with Shackle with JavaScript and Shackle Sparkle. And finally, there is this thing called stems, but this is almost a detail and can't be simulated in Shackle, where, for example, you can say, okay, the employee must have a property homepage which must start by company.com/whatever. In Shackle, you should go to do this with Shackle Sparkle. So you have in Shackle Sparkle, you define this constraint component where you are checking that the stem starts with this value, and then you could define this stem. Okay, but you could do that, but you need Shackle Sparkle. Okay, so then looking to the to the Slack channel, I am in the Slack channel. The only message I think is from Simon saying that he's leaving. Any other question about sex versus soccer? No. Okay, let's continue. I have this. This is a quite new set of slides, and this is this is an introduction to Sex and Soccer Foundations. Probably I will do it in not very much detail, but just as an appetizer, if you want to read the papers on sex and soccer. So I think this, I mean, the people who are working on sex and soccer, we write papers and submit the papers to the Semantic Web Conference, and we like those papers to be read and to be cited. Maybe you sometimes you are afraid of some formalisms. So just as an appetizer, I wanted to define what is the abstract syntax of sex and shackle and the semantics and a very simple validation algorithm. Okay, I'm not planning to go into all the details, but I think this exercise maybe is interesting for this audience. So let's go. First, an overview of the RDF data model. As you could see in a lot of papers about the RDF data model, you can have an RDF graph is a set of triples, and you have the subject, the predicate, and the object. And this is an example of a graph. Then, in order to, I did this just to so the slides are self-containable. So I also added some proper operations on RDF graphs that we are going to use in the slides. For example, we will need to obtain the neighborhood of a node, and the neighborhood of a node is called, if you have for every triple XPY that belongs to the graph, we take only the triples that start by X. So for example, the neighborhoods of Alice, the neighborhood of Alice would be only these two triples. If we have Alice here, these are these two triples. Extract is to extract a triple from a graph. So for example, if you can extract from this graph, one possible extraction is to extract one triple, which would be Alice, and you'd have the rest of. And another operation that we will do a lot in sex is partition. And partition is when you take a graph and you obtain all the graphs whose union is that graph. This is wrong. Here I have to add that S1 intersection S2 is the empty set. Otherwise, the definition is not why I have just seen that. Okay, so this is the operations. And now let's go to the abstract syntax of sex. The abstract syntax of sex is this definition. Sex has like two levels in the definition. You have like one level is shape expressions, another level is triple expressions, and shape expressions are constraints on nodes. So these are the possible constraints on nodes, and triple expressions are constraints on the properties that depart from a node. So you have one possibility is that you have a predicate that conforms to one shape with a reference to a shape, or you have each of triple expression one and triple expression two, so you have two triple expressions, or a disjunction, or a regular expression which is a star. And this is one possibility, and the other possibility is shape expressions, where you have conjunction, disjunction, negation, a reference to a shape label, or a triple expression, a basic triple expression. I'm not taking here into account closed shapes and extra. And this is an example of how you could represent, with this abstract syntax, you could represent an example. For example, here this is GSU has a code which is a positive integer, so this is a condition, and is reported by a user. A user is an IRI and has name, which is a string, and knows another user. A star means that it can know zero or more values. And here the string is just excess. This is the condition that it belongs to a string. So this is an example of how you can represent a schema. A schema is an association between labels and shape expressions. You can represent that with this abstract syntax. And now the other part, the usual part, is how to invoke. Well, this is another thing, is fixed same maps is what is the result of the validation, and the result of the validation is just a list of associations between nodes and shape expression labels. So for example, you say Alice, I want to validate Alice as a user, Bob as check that it is not a user, or Carol as a user. I have to say that in most of the papers, you will see that shape maps are also called shape assignments or shape typings. Okay, so you could see that those different names. This is just, you can overview that, those are some definitions. And as I said, this is the semantics. The semantics, one way to define the semantics of shape expressions is using this kind of type system rules, and the type system rules are just rules from logic where you have, this is the conclusion, so this, you have the conclusion, and this is the premises. So for example, the in the case of AND, in the case of AND, if you have a shape expression 1 and a shape expression 2, you must check that the node conforms to the first shape expression and also conforms to the second shape expression. So this is the AND. In the case of a OR, the node should conform to either shape expression 1 or to shape expression 2. In the case of an IRI, you just check that the node belongs to this IRI. If it is a blank node, you check that the node is a blank node. And if this is a condition, you just check that the condition applied to this node is true. And finally, if you have a triple expression, you check that the neighborhood of this node, you check the neighborhood of this node, and you obtain a set of triples, and you check that this set of triples match this triple expression. And the triple expression is defined in the next slide, and this is this definition. This definition says, if you have each of triple expression, you create a partition of those triple expressions. So you obtain those two sets of triple expressions, and you check one of the sets of triple expressions and another of the sets of triple expressions. And this is the most complex operation in the validation of shape expressions, because this partition is exponential. So if you don't, if you are not very careful, this algorithm could be very complex. So that's, and that's true, and that's why we need to do some optimizations on the implementation of shape expressions. There is also the disjunction, where you just check if either these triples match one of the triple expressions or the other of the triple expressions. And then for each triple constraint, you have a set of triples, and this set of triples is just one triple, so that's the cardinality is one, and the triple is has this predicate with this value, you check that this value matches this shape expression. Okay, so this is the triple constraints. You just check the values of the predicates. And finally, if you have a star in a regular expressions, if you have a star, you either match directly if the triples are empty, or if the triples are not empty, you have to extract one triple from the set of triples. You match that triple with the triple expression, and you continue with the rest of the triples. You continue matching with TE star. Okay, until you arrive to the empty triple expression. Okay, so this was the semantics. I also have a slide with the validation algorithm, but I probably will skip this because I wanted to talk about shape applications and tools. And then I did the same for the SACL abstract syntax. So the SACL abstract syntax is simpler than in the case of sex, because they don't have this disjunction between triple expressions. So this is the abstract syntax, and this is the semantics and the validation algorithm. So this is, as I said, it was just an appetizer for validations, but also to see shape expressions and SACL from this point of view, from this abstract point of view, you can see the similarities and the differences between both. Okay. So this is about the foundations of Second Circle. If you want to, if you are interested in this kind of things, and I hope if you are attending the tutorial that you are interested, there are several papers that you could take a look at those papers and you can read about that. And this is a short list. There is the definition of the sex language. This was the first paper where we defined the sex language, and we were using, at that point, we didn't have negation. We had a recursion, but we didn't have negation. Later, we started to add negation without, I mean, we started to have negation. No, here is the paper where we had the negation. But this one, this paper, was studying the complexity of the validation. And in fact, the algorithms that we are using are defined in this paper from Stavorko. Then in 2017, the Sackler recommendation appeared, and the Sackler has negation but no recursion. And so this is the Sackler W3C recommendation. And then, but at the same time, I think this is, was probably at the same time, it wasn't 3 years ago, Iovka Boneva defined a version of sex with negation and recursion using stratification. Then there was this paper from Julian Korman from a year later that added for Sackler, but as I said, this is not for the recommendation of Sackler. This is just an abstract version of the of Sackler. I also have an implementation that converts between sex and Sackler. It's a partial implementation, but it works for some subset. I also have a paper. This paper is where what I do is, you have sex, you have Sackler, you define a subset, you combine sex to a language called S, and you can implement that language. So this is like a low-level language called the S language that is able to implement both sex and Sackler. In fact, I also implemented this language compiling this to Klingo, to ASP. So I have an implementation compiling this. I didn't write a paper about that. Now I saw that there was a recent paper defining a stable model semantics for Sackler that is very similar to what I had done there, but at that moment point of time, I was not writing papers. I just did an implementation in Sackler. So you can see that this implementation where you have this S language, which is implemented compiling it to Klingo. So this was in this paper that I have that. And also there is something that we are working right now in my research group. It's called SexLite, which is a table-based subset of both sex and Sackler. And you can use, so this is this SexLite, you can use this SexLite to generate Java code. This is something that I will show later in an example. Okay, so these are some references, the papers, if you are interested to take a look at those papers. Okay, and let's go to the last set.